About connected reductive stuff. So G is a connected reductive algebraic group over an algebraic closure with the field of the field with p elements. We have a Frobenius map. We take fixed points. We get such a finite group of Lie type, and our aim is to understand the ordinary irreducible characters of such a group. Now, we saw last time that a good way to think about these things is by using these characters, these virtual characters RT theta of Deligne and Lustig, which were defined using this complicated theory, LRD cohomology. Just a quick summary, what we had. I said these are class functions of which you can compute at least in principle the values. I didn't say exactly how to do it, but there is a kind of algorithm how to do that. Secondly, they are virtual characters. In general, they are not irreducible, but at least every irreducible occurs in some such RT theta. And by developing this whole theory, you can get really a parametrization of the irreducible characters in terms of unipotent characters and what I call the Jordan decomposition, which I also didn't explain in detail, but I said that in the end you can parametrize all irreducible characters by using this idea of unipotent ones for G itself and a collection of smaller groups. Yeah? So all this was somehow state of the art around mid-80s. There's Lustig's book, which contains exactly this. Yeah? So in particular, what he achieves in this book is to derive these formulas for decomposing such an RT theta in irreducible characters. Yeah? In this little gap session that I did at the end of the last lecture, I showed you how this works for unipotent characters, but something similar can be done for any RT theta. So this is completely known how these things decompose into irreducible characters. And by looking at this more closely, you can get a parametrization. That means you can really give names to the irreducible characters and work with that. And what you can get out of this is, for example, nice formulas for the degrees of characters. Yeah? I mentioned these, you can even attach a well-defined polynomial to each character which gives the degree. And as you learned in other lectures, many people will just be happy by knowing the characters, being able to enumerate them and knowing their degrees. But in the end, of course, we would like to know the character tables. Yeah? So we also want to know values on other elements. And for this purpose, this theory is not sufficient. So what Lustig then did is to invent this theory of character sheaves. So this will be the subject of today's lecture. So just first a few words about that. So this was set off by one long article in Inventiones, more than 70 pages long. Then there is a series of papers, character sheaves 1 to 5, written in 2 years. I just mention here the main articles. There are several articles around this. Later then, Lustig extended this theory also to groups which are not connected, which in the end will also be useful for finite groups because you will want to study automorphism groups and such things. And you see this is disconnected groups 1 to 10. Yeah? It's 10 parts. Yeah? And each of these articles is some 30, 40 pages long. And the story is not finished there, especially over the last couple of years. There were some exciting new developments by getting a completely new way of looking at these things by using this idea of categorical centers. So this I will not say anything at all. I'm just saying while this is actually already quite a mature area, I mean, it started in the 1980s, there are still really new and exciting things going on. Now, this looks heavy stuff, doesn't it? Yes. And, and this is the last talk, so it should be something a bit more relaxing. Yeah? So perhaps before we really have the courage to look at this, let's try to understand why we really need this, huh? Why the RT theta business is not enough to deal with this problem. Huh? Okay, so let's try to answer the question, how far can we get really if we just work in this world of the RT thetas, with which we may be more happy to work with. Huh? So just a little bit of notation, we just look at the vector space of all class functions on GF, then of course it has a scalar product, our good old irreducible characters form an orthonormal basis of that, and now this definition here, we call a class function uniform if it can be written as a linear combination of RT thetas. Yeah? This is a natural definition once you have this set up. So just a few examples. The character of the regular representation is uniform. Trivial character is uniform. The Steinberg character is uniform. Also this class of class functions is uniform. So you call a class function P constant if it is constant on P sections. Yeah? So if it only depends, if the values only depend on the semi-simple part of an element, yeah, then such a thing is uniform. It's a useful, very useful thing. And then there is this theorem, which was already conjectured by Lustig a long time ago. And it says the following. So let C be an F-stable conjugacy class in our group G. If we take fixed points of such a CF, of course, all we can say in general is that it will just be a union of classes in the finite group. Yeah? But let's look at the indicator function of such an algebraic set, let's say. And then, yeah, so this is really one if G is in CF and zero otherwise. So this is a function which is one on a few conjugacy classes in your finite groups. And the point is these are uniform, yeah? All these. This you can show. Yeah? I think a proof, it must be known to Lustig that this is possible. So I wrote up a proof there in a survey article that I wrote a couple of years ago. But it really uses everything that you know about these RT thetas. It's a very hard theorem. Yeah? But you see, I mean, many functions are uniform. So what can you do with this? So let's now take an irreducible character and let's take such an F-stable conjugacy class. Then we simply define this rho average. We take the average value of a character over such a set. Yeah? This 1 over GF is just that the formulas are nicer and I don't have to carry this factor, but it's basically taking such an average value. Yeah? And then, of course, I can use the previous theorem to say something about these average values. Namely, if I take an irreducible character, then I can first write it, decompose it as a sum of two class functions, namely the uniform part, which I can write as a linear combination of RT thetas, and simply the rest, which is in the orthogonal complement of this subspace. And then, of course, this average value is just the scalar product of rho with this indicator function. Now I write I decompose rho in this way, and then of course the second summand is zero because I just mentioned this theorem. I mean, it's this indicator function is uniform. Yeah? So it's just the scalar product of the uniform projection with my epsilon c, and this is known. In this sense that I always said, functions can be computed in principle. So let's just spell this out once more. The scalar products of rho with any RT theta are known from Lustig's book, or remember, as I showed in the gap session for unipotent characters. So I can write, in principle, this uniform projection as a linear combination of RT thetas. Secondly, this scalar product of an RT theta with this epsilon function is just the average value of RT theta on the CF. And since I said the values of RT theta can be computed in principle, so this I can work out. And then, of course, I can work out this scalar product using A and B. Yeah? So, conclusion. I can at least, using the theory of these RT thetas, work out, let's say, this average value character table. Yeah? For every irreducible character and every F-stable conjugacy class, I consider these average values, and these I can really get a grip on just by using the theory of these RT thetas. Yeah? You can perhaps get a little more than just these average values, but in speaking, if we look for a nice, clean statement, this is somehow the optimal thing that you can expect from there. Yeah?
Do we know how they break up? I mean, how these, you said this conjugacy class, you know, this CF is a union of...
Yes.
Do we know how they...
Yeah, so perhaps I will say a little bit more later on. So if you have a C and F stable conjugacy class, so in G, then exercise Lang-Steinberg. First of all, the fixed point set is non-empty, so you pick an element here. And then what controls how this splits up into the finite group is this little group, which always called A of, it's the centralizer, modulo the connected part of the centralizer. So this is a little finite group. And essentially, this class here splits up in as many classes in the finite groups as you have conjugacy classes in this group. Yeah? So in particular, if your centralizer is connected, then you just get one class. Sorry? No. This is works always. Huh? This is just Lang-Steinberg. So let's look at examples. First, our... As I said, in the setting of this whole theory, GLN is the trivial case. So why it is trivial in this setting? Let's take a conjugacy class. Well, what is true in GLN is centralizers of elements are connected. Yeah? This is, you can even see very simply because if you take a matrix, you want to work out its centralizer in GLN. Well, first you look at its centralizer in the whole matrix algebra. So it will be a subspace. It's something connected. And then you take determinant non-zero, so it's some principal open set, so it's still connected. Yeah? So this is really easy. Yeah? And so in this setup, really, as I mentioned here, then you know that for every F-stable conjugacy class of G, the CF is just one conjugacy class in the finite group. So this average value business is just a scalar matrix of a scalar multiple of actual character values. So this means I get really, yeah, can compute in principle, yeah, I can recover the whole character table from the knowledge of the RT thetas. Huh? In this sense, again, GLN is trivial. Shouldn't really say that, but I mean, and this also works uniformly for GLN and GU. This is also one advantage of this point of view. If you came just from the theory of finite groups, there's no reason why there should be similarities between the character table of GLN and GUN, but from this point of view, you can treat things quite uniformly. Okay, so that's fine. So let's look now at other examples. Yeah, next one is SL2 over a field of odd characteristic, and so finite group is just SL2Q. So here I take the conjugacy class in the algebraic group of elements with this Jordan normal form. You work out easily that the centralizer is not connected. So this class will split. And here it's very easy to see how it splits. Of course, you have this representative and another one where you put here in this corner an element which is not a square. Yeah? There I use that Q is odd, that this is something which works in odd characteristic. Now, these are so-called regular unipotent elements, and that's a theorem in Dillon-Lustig that these RT thetas have just value 1 on all regular unipotent elements. So in particular, all the RT thetas have the same value on n and m prime, so they cannot distinguish these two classes. Yeah? Yeah, so they don't do this, so there we have an instant where the average value is something easier than the actual character values. So there must be some non-uniform characters, and I guess many of you have seen how to make the character table of SL2. This is not such a big deal. You have to work a little bit to get that, but you know there are these characters of degree a half q plus 1 and a half q minus 1. These are the troublemakers there. And on the elements n and n primes, they take these values. Huh? This you work out. Huh? And this you can do by elementary methods. Huh? So you have a kind of Clifford theory problem. First you do GL2. Then you just have characters of degree q plus 1, q minus 1. And then some of these restrict reducibly. You have to split up these two constituents, and they give you these values. Okay, so let's push this a little bit further. Let's do the following. We take this linear combination of these four characters. So since I didn't write the values on the other elements, you cannot check that. But if you just check on n and n prime, so I take the difference of the first two, the difference of the second two, so these halves will disappear and so on. So you will notice, we'll find out, that this function just takes these values on n and prime and is zero everywhere else. Yeah, so for this you need to know the other values, but you can just work this out. And you see, of course, also that this F0 is really orthogonal to all RT thetas. Now, why did I write it in this way? Well, you see, this F0 is a class function which is just non-zero on these two elements, n and n prime. But on the other hand, it is only just a linear combination of very few irreducible characters. There are just four characters involved in this. And now tell me, if you know, have you seen many character tables in your life? Can this happen really very often, that you have a class function with non-zero values on just very, very few elements, classes, but which are a linear combination only of very few characters? You shake your head, rightly so. I like to call this a miracle in the character table. Yeah? But of course, we don't believe in miracles. This is an example of a characteristic function of an F-stable character sheaf. There are the character sheafs. Yeah? So I will explain this later on, just to give you an appetizer on, you can see this incredibly complicated theory of character sheaves in SL2. If you like, take A5. You can see it in A5, SL2, not A4, yeah, SL2. Nah, anyway, yeah, so you can see it in small character tables also. Let's do another example. SP4. P odd, just the four-dimensional symplectic group. The complete character table was worked out by Bama Srinivasan. It's a long paper. Of course, many computations you do. You start with parabolic subgroups, work out character tables of this, induce characters. You hope to get as much as you can. But then in the end, you are missing some functions. And so, of course, I will not write this all in detail. I just give you the essence of it. In the end, there was one function which lives on the elements with this Jordan normal form. So it's an element, it's a mixed element, which has a semi-simple part, an involution, and unipotent part, a regular unipotent element in the centralizer. This class splits up into four classes in the finite group. And so, yeah, in Bama's paper, these four classes are called, if you want to check this later, yeah, D31, D32, 33, 34. And she has a function there, gamma 1 it's called, which just has values q minus q minus q, q on these four elements, and zero anywhere else. Yeah, so this is on somewhere in the middle of a long, complicated discussion on page 513 in the paper, if you want to check it. And the point is, again, Yeah, you have a function with very few non-zero values, but it's only a linear combination of four irreducible characters. Huh? And now, again, this is orthogonal to all RT thetas, and nowadays that we have this theory of character sheaves available, we can see it's an example of a characteristic function of an F-stable character sheaf. Now, you can, if you like this spot, you can check various other tables that you simply that exist in the literature, which have been worked out. For example, the table of G2 of Q, worked out by Chang and Ri, or triality groups, Spaltenstein. There's a similar thing. You have they induce from many subgroups and so on, and then there are a few troublemaker classes on which you have to find somehow the values of the irreducible characters. And if you organize it with our today's knowledge, you will see that you can always come up with exactly such a picture. Yeah? There's one conjugacy class in the algebraic group, it splits up, and then you have a function which has simple values and is only a linear combination of very few irreducible characters. Yeah? A similar thing occurred in Kavanaka's work on so-called generalized Gelfand-Greif representations. You can also see this. And of course, there is another, if you want to check such things, there's another huge source of character tables, isn't there? Where would you look for examples of character tables? And the Atlas, of course. The Atlas, of course. Yeah? There are a few Chevalier groups in the Atlas, yeah? Like SP63, the eight-dimensional orthogonal groups, F4 of 2. Well, E6 of 2 is not printed there, but it's in the GAP library. And you can see even in these individual character tables where the field is not a variable Q, you can see the examples of these functions, yeah? Of such miracles, as I called it. Yeah? So now we see, now it's clear, I mean, it was also at that time, I mean, Chang and Ri, they worked this out. It was quite an effort. Spaltenstein used all the power of the RT theta business. Bama Srinivasan did not yet have that available. She only used elementary methods. But with the information available at that time, it was clear there is something complicated going on, and you couldn't see the pattern which really governs this whole thing. Yeah? And this pattern which governs the whole thing is with nowadays, look on it, the theory of character sheaves. So now we are prepared now. Yeah? Okay. So the world in which we have to work is this famous asterisk volume of Behlinson, Bernstein, and Deligne, Faisceau Pervers. So this theory of perverse sheaves. The category in which all this lives is this what they call this DG, the bounded derived category of constructible QL sheaves. So I don't know really what these objects are. Yeah? But it is like, so if you know, for example, Carter's book on finite groups of Lie type, where he expounds this theory of the RT thetas, it uses LRD cohomology. What he does there is he makes a list of, what is it, 15 axioms. So you just say you have a variety associated to a variety is a collection of finite dimensional vector spaces. They have some functorial properties, a few other things. And with this, you can work then. You can get a working knowledge and really prove theorems about these RT thetas. Now, it will be much harder just to have such a black box arrangement about these constructible sheaves, because it's not just a collection of vector spaces, it's sheaves, okay. From a basic algebraic topology course, you know what sheaves are, but these are QL sheaves, so this is this Etal topology, yeah, this Grothendieck topology, so it's something much more complicated. But again, at least, if one is willing to use a little bit the language of sheaves and accept that although they are not sheaves in the good old sense, but they have similar properties. They behave nicely. You have maps between spaces, and this induces maps and so on. Yeah? So you can acquire a kind of working knowledge of this as well. So we think of the objects here simply as complexes of QL sheaves. A complex has a cohomology sheaf attached to it, yeah, because it's not exact in general. So it's again a sheaf. And then for every element in the underlying space, you have stalks. And this is this constructible. I mean, one point about this is the kind of finiteness conditions that these are finite dimensional vector spaces. So there again, you have a machine which produces finite dimensional vector spaces in the end. Yeah? And then these character sheaves, Lustig just denotes them by G hat. These are certain things which live in this category. So these are there's a notion of irreducibility, perverse sheaves in this of such complexes, which have the additional property. I mean, G is not just an algebraic variety, it's a group which acts, and you look at the conjugation action of G on itself, and these things should be equivariant with respect to that action. Yeah? So I don't need to, I will not go to any more detail about the definition of this. For the purposes of this talk, it's just fine if we live in here. Yeah? The first remark is, these are things which really live on the algebraic group. Yeah? There's no F there. Yeah? It's objects which are associated to the underlying G. Now let's plug in also our F. What can we do with the F? It's a morphism of variety. I said these things behave friendly with respect to this. So you look at this inverse image functor, which gives you a new such complex, which has the property that all we need in the end will be these torques. It has this property then. Yeah? This is also what would happen with classical sheaves and stalk, and it's true here in this setting. Now, let's further assume that this inverse image is isomorphic to the K in this category. Then we choose an isomorphism. And this isomorphism will induce linear maps. I have a map here. I just take cohomology sheaves and then stalks. So I get linear maps here. And now you see, if I combine these two things, and if I also assume that I have an element in my finite group, well, then this thing is equal to this. This is this property. But if G is fixed, I just have this again. So this phi here will just be a linear map of this stalk into itself. Yeah? Yeah? So definition, character sheaves, part 2, 8.4.1. Pick it up again. We take such a complex, which is F-stable. We choose an isomorphism. We've just seen it induces linear maps on each stalk at a point in GF. So I can define a function in this way. I just take the alternating sum of the traces as I runs there. So it's the bounded derived category, so there are only finitely many I's for which is non-zero. And in this way, you can associate it with this incredibly complicated object, a function on the finite group. And this is called by Lustig the characteristic function of K. And this is, of course, the main point. Since we have this equivariance condition with respect to conjugation action, it should not come as a surprise that this is not just any function, but a class function. Yeah? So here you have a geometric source of class functions on your finite group. Yeah? You see, these are class functions which do not come from representations or something. It's really, It comes from this equivariance condition. A tricky point that I want to mention here right away. You see, I always say, I insist, choose an isomorphism. So what is true is that if you take an irreducible such complex, like a character sheaf, there's something like Schur's lemma for that. So this phi will be unique up to a non-zero scalar. So these functions are only well-defined in the end up to non-zero scalars. And there is a real issue. You can't discuss this away. Yeah? You have to, when you really work this out and find these scalars, you have to fix this isomorphism. Okay, now just to make the link with the miracles before. So remember in our algebraic group, we have this setup, Borel, torus, parabolic subgroups, Levy subgroups, which are again connected reductive. We saw that in the finite groups, you can set up a kind of inductive procedure to produce characters, this Harish-Chandra induction and restriction. And something similar is possible here as well. There's a geometric induction procedure to go from character sheaves of L to character sheaves of G, which is really, it has similar formal properties like this ordinary Harish-Chandra induction for characters. In particular, you have a notion of cuspidal things. Cuspidal were the things that never show up in such a properly induced thing. So in this way, you get a notion of cuspidal character sheaves. Yeah? And this we just denote by G0 hat. And now the point is, these miraculous functions that I had shown you, the F0 for SL2, Bama's gamma 1, and the other ones, they are really characteristic functions of F-stable cuspidal character sheaves. Yeah? So these are somehow the true core of this whole theory. Yeah? Like in ordinary character theory, the cuspidal ones are, this you have to understand at the end of the day, and it's the same in this theory of character sheaves. And now you have already seen examples of cuspidal character sheaves. Now, if my group is a simple algebraic group, as in the examples, SL2, SP4, G2, then there's only a fixed finite number of cuspidal character sheaves. Yeah? And all possibilities have been completely classified by Lustig in these character sheaves 1 to 5. For example, if you take E8, which we want to do one day, there are 13 cuspidal character sheaves, so 13 of, as you see, troublemaker functions or miraculous functions, regardless of characteristic, be it bad characteristic 2 or 3 or whatever, there are always 13 cuspidal character sheaves. And one would like to do exactly what one can see in the character tables of SL2 and SP4. Yeah, you have to find out on which conjugacy class these cuspidal things live, write down the values there, make a good normalization of this phi, and express this as a small linear combination of irreducible characters. Yeah? Small in E8 is relative. Yeah? It will not just be 4 irreducible characters. It may be 100, but it will not be a polynomial in Q. It will just be a fixed number. Yeah? So this is one thing that, this I also find fascinating in this whole theory, that on the one hand, you can spend your life just trying to understand the theory and prove general theorems, but in the end there are some very concrete things that you can really work out there and put even on a computer. Huh? Someday we want to have these things on a computer like the things that I showed you in the little gap session. Okay, so here's one of the main results of this whole theory of character sheaves. I will say a little bit about the reference is there. So first of all, for every character sheaf which is F-stable, And we saw one can choose such an isomorphism. And the first result is at least one can make a choice such that the values of these things, and I mean, there's at least a little control about this. These are cyclotomic numbers, yeah? So can be written as linear combinations of roots of unity. And the norm of this thing in the usual scalar product is one. Secondly, somehow in analogy to these RT thetas, where I always said you can compute the values in principle, there's a kind of algorithm, a similar thing exists for these functions here. You can really work out the values of this thing. And third result is if you take all F stable character sheaves, choose phi as in A, such that this thing has norm 1, then you really get a new orthonormal basis of your space of class functions. Yeah? So this is somehow good news that you really, the theory has on one extreme these cuspital things, which are just these tiny little functions. But if you see the whole picture, you really get a new basis of class functions. And another point is also, you see, first of all, these things live on the algebraic group. So somehow you have a something on the level of this algebraic group, which whenever you choose a Frobenius map, descends down to a basis of your concrete GF. So this is a first indication which explains why the character tables of all these groups work so smoothly with respect to Q. Yeah? You don't have to work out the character table for each individual Q. No, there's some uniform thing going on. This is one indication for that, yeah? Because things come from one object in the algebraic group. Now, so how is this proved? This is character sheaves 5, paragraph 25. This is really the very last part of the character sheaves papers. And really, it uses basically everything before. So the proof of this result is some 200 pages long. And there, Lustig had to impose a mild condition on P, his story about bad primes. So this he couldn't resolve there. And then he could finally get a result without any condition on P. This is this article in 2012. It's called Cleanness of Cuspital Character Sheaves. So there he could remove these conditions. So this theorem is really true unconditionally. Huh? Center connected or not, bad prime or not, for any connected reductive group. Huh? And as a small side remark here, actually, especially yeah, in this paper in 2012, the proof there is not a purely theoretical argument. He actually has to use some computations, some non-trivial computations, using these GAP and Chevy programs. Yeah? So he also acknowledges this, this dependence of this fantastic result on actual computer calculation. And the way he used this is the following. So a little earlier, he had a series of papers where he had come up with a nice idea to relate conjugacy classes of the Weyl group with unipotent classes of G. Yeah, this is in itself a beautiful story. So he could define in elementary terms such a surjective map here. And in order to prove the existence of this map, he had to do computer calculations for exceptional groups, in particular E8. And this map plays a part in the proof of this result there. Okay. Now, this, so we have this new basis of the space of class functions. So how is this related now to irreducible characters? And the problem that I started with, compute character tables of groups, of finite groups of Lie type. So the conjecture is this formula. So what, all I have to do now in the last minutes is explain this formula. Huh? But this you can really carry with you home. It's not complicated, just one formula. So first of all, the conjecture is an equality of class functions on GF. And this little epsilon there is a root of unity. The left-hand side we have seen. These are just the characteristic functions of F-stable character sheaves. I explained this before how to do this. So the point is the left-hand side, hence, is the class functions whose values we can compute in principle. Now, what is this right-hand side? The right-hand side, these are these Rx's. These have been called almost characters by Lustig. So they were first defined in his book, assuming that the group, the algebraic group, has a connected center, so GLN and not SLN. And the general definition, Lustig only wrote up a couple of years ago. It's technically much more complicated. So what are these almost characters? So they are explicit linear combinations of irreducible characters via what Lustig calls his non-abelian Fourier transform. And yeah, so what does this mean? So because we want to work out the character table, so how can I take an explicit linear combination? Well, the point is that from the results of his book, you have a parameterization at least. You can give names to the irreducible characters. And so it also makes sense using these names to define certain linear combinations of the irreducible characters where the coefficients somehow depend on this parameter set, of course. And this is this what he calls this non-abelian Fourier matrix. So in the examples that I showed you, this F0 in SL2 and so on, these little linear combinations of four irreducible characters, these are examples of such almost characters. So typically it's not integral linear combinations. You have a denominator. In the examples that I had, it was just a half. In E8, you will have examples where you have 1 over 120. In classical groups in general, it will always be 1 over a power of 2. So it's some nice combinatorics going on there. Yeah? So you can write down these are almost characters. So the point is then the right-hand side of this equation is a class function whose decomposition in terms of the irreducible characters, I know, but not the values. Yeah? And now you see the beauty of this conjecture. Yeah? You want to equate two class functions on the one side. You can compute the values, but you don't know how it decomposes into irreducible characters. On the other hand, you know how it decomposes, but you don't know the values. And if you have equality, you get both. So that's here is the tricky bit once more. To get this right, yeah, you have to make definite choices of these isomorphisms for your characteristic functions. Yeah? So this is somehow the critical bit in this story. So what is the status of this conjecture? It is known in many cases, but not in complete generality. So for example, the most, let's say the biggest part of knowledge here is Shoji's work. So he proved, this was already in the 1990s, he proved this conjecture for all G, where the center of G is connected. Yeah? First he also had some conditions on the prime numbers, good primes and so on. This can now be removed after Lustig proved this cleanness business. So this is in itself also a huge piece of work. And one should also say, well, he proved this equality without yet saying in all cases what this epsilon is. So this still remains to be determined. And as I say, this depends on making these choices. And this seems to be an extremely difficult part in this whole story. So we know that this is true up to these scalars. Yeah? So if we really want to make the character table of E8 of 25, set up this whole machinery, but there will be some roots of unity that I still have to work out. Then as far as non-connected centers are concerned, the story is in general pretty open, I would say. So there's a whole book that Cédric Bonnafé wrote about SLN. And here even, I think he still has a condition on P and Q. You can take any P, but Q has to be a sufficiently large power of P, which is, of course, a horrible condition. And to clean up these things is, what is undankbar in English? Yeah, it's thankless. Yeah, yeah, it's a thankless task to work this out. Of course, people will be happy if somebody really works it out. But it will be technically a hard, difficult work to do. Just to say, okay, before it was known for 25, but not for 5. Yeah, and now I also know it for 5. Okay, so the whole point, in any case, is. You can get the character tables of these finite groups, and the way to do this is by unwrapping this this equality there. Yeah? It maybe is not the solution that one would have imagined in the beginning. I mean, there's a whole whole apparatus to understand, even to be able to make sense to this word, but. This idea has been formulated already in the original character sheaves papers by Lustig, so around 85, and since today there is nothing better than that. This is all we have. Huh? Nobody has come up with any other clever idea how to work out character tables of these groups. So I'm actually a little bit early, but this is the end point here.
So for H, so there are 13 classical character sheaves, but they break into this series. So the unipotent ones.
In E8, they are all unipotent. Yeah, it's a speciality for E8. Or G2, it's the same, or F4, they are all unipotent one. But in classical groups, they really go across series. Yeah? Yeah.
For cuspidal character sheaves, do you get only characters of cuspidal representations, or do you get?
No, there are also others. Yeah, these linear combinations of these four characters that I had, they were not all cuspidal. Sorry?
Two of them were cuspidal.
Yeah, but this is in general. Is there always a cuspidal one? I'm not sure. Yeah, but there are definitely non-cuspidal ones involved. Yeah.
Okay, but is there some connections?
No, not really. Not really. No.
I want to say we know the character table of SLN.
Do we? Then please give me a different reference than Cédric Bonnafé's book. No, we don't know.
So,
I think it's, what is the smallest scale? SL6 or so is already troublesome. Huh?
So yes, GL and SL are different.
Yeah, very different. And you see, there will not just be one character table. It depends on the GCD of Q and N minus 1, of Q minus 1 and N. Cool. Yeah. You have the center of SLN.
I'm sorry you said that.
The center of SLN has order, what is it, the GCD of Q minus 1 and N. So if N divides Q minus 1, it's the worst case somehow. And so you will have different character tables even. Yeah. So SL6 is really... I think it's not completely worked out how the character table looks like. Huh? Yeah?
Do the experts have any idea how one could maybe transfer the character sheaf theory to like produce something like modular character sheaves?
Yeah, where's Olivier? I think he's But it's the same idea as with the LRD cohomology. You want to do modular representations, L modular, and there is already the L. Yeah, your constructions are originally over L, so it looks very reasonable and sensible to expect that there is something. But up to now, I don't think there's much there. Yeah? Yeah, yeah. Okay.
I want to thank all of the speakers for all their work and for a fantastic job.